So hi everyone. So it's a real pleasure to be here for this kind of last session of Embedded Linux Conference. It's my first time here at ELC. I'm mostly attending academic conferences because I'm a professor at University of Rennes. I'm a scientist in INRIA team, and basically, we're working on software in general, and in particular in software variants. So some keywords like software product line, configurable system, generators are our relevant topics. And of course, Linux was in our radar because it's a very interesting project from many perspectives. And this talk is mainly a teasing for these two papers. So it's mainly an introduction to some results we have. So if you want to have more details, you can have a look. I'm really welcome to have feedbacks on it. And it's a joint work with many people here at Rennes. So you can see the list here. So back to our topic, Linux. So Linux is interesting from many perspectives, and maybe one major feature of Linux is high configurability. It's kind of incredible, right? You can embed Linux in very small devices. You can run it on a desktop application, on cloud computing, on edge computing, on supercomputing. Why? Because you have options that you can combine to fit your requirements. So I just put an excerpt of a kconfig file, right, for documenting two options. One is a Boolean options. So yes or no, and you can see there are many dependencies and documentation. And there is another which is tree state, so it can take yes, no, or module value, and again, there is a kind of dependency. And as a user of the kernel, you can configure Linux with either a configurator or through the editing of a .config file that respects the constraints of a kconfig document file. And what we observe is that there is an increase in the number of options, and it does not stop. So I have taken just two architecture, x86 and ARM, but that's the same trend for all architecture. So we have gained something like 3,000 options between Linux 4 and Linux 5. Yeah, it's kind of incredible, right? You have 15,000 options that you can combine. So it's kind of even, right? That's why Linux is so popular. It's because you can combine all these options to fit your requirements. But it can also be a kind of nightmare, right? Because there are many failures that pop up due to wrong interaction between options. So you activate two options together, and suddenly there is something wrong. So there is a bug. And it's really specific to this combination. So developers and maintainers are struggling to track bugs, right? I can see it in the mailing list. We can see it in the mailing list. And hopefully they can fix bugs. Sometimes it can take time. So Linus say that there are random crazy user bugs. I think there are random configuration that cause these bugs. And that's why it's so crazy sometimes, right? So in practice, we use lots of static analysis and are very useful to avoid some bugs. But they may miss some bugs, and we are relying on testing. It means that you take a few configs and you build them and you test their properties. So there are some initiatives like Zero Day from Intel or Kernel CI. You see the talk 2 days ago. They are trained to test the Linux kernel in the large. Another problem more related to non-functional property. If I give you a kernel configuration, a .config file, can you give me the size of the kernel, of the binary, or the compressed size? Can you give me the boot time it will take? Is there any person in the room that can do that? Yeah, it's kind of hard, right? It's not your fault. It's just because there are too many options and too many possible interactions between options that it's hard to anticipate every case. But yeah, we deal with that, and there are some default configuration, default options values that are set up based on some knowledge, right? There is part of the documentation that states whether some options have an effect on size or not, but in practice, yeah, it's a know-how, right? It's experience, it's test and try. So the general problem is to tame the configuration space. So by taming, I mean understanding the effects of all possible combination of options on build status, on bootability, on size, on boot time, on performance, on security, whatever. And yeah, the problem is the number of options. So 15,000 options. If I made some statistics, most of the options are three state, yes, no module. So it can take three values. There are lots of Boolean value, so only two. But if you combine all together, that may be this huge number of configuration. Well, I'm voluntarily exaggerating here because I do not count constraints. But that gives you the order of complexity. Actually, it's an open problem at the research level to know how many configurations there are in the Linux kernel. We don't know. So it's interesting, right? And yeah, let's put this number in perspective. Yeah, a configuration, it's a .config, but it's also something real at the end. It's a kernel that you need to build, to measure, etc. So it has a cost. So yeah, let's put the number in perspective. So with this new huge number of configuration, it's much more than the estimated number of atoms in the universe. It's much more than the estimated number of possible chess positions. So Shannon made an over approximation. Now it's 10 power to 40, which is something, right? And yeah, just to make a comparison, if we look at AlphaZero, you know, the super artificial intelligence that plays in an excellent way at chess, right? So there is this number of possible options, of possible configurations that are different, right? But also, if we look at the exploration of the configuration space, on Linux, it takes 10 minutes on average to compile a kernel on a recent machine. So on tiny config, it's a few seconds, right? But it can be up to 1 hour according to our experiments. In chess, in Go, it's really cheap to explore the configuration space. You don't have to wait 10 minutes to know the outcome of a position, let's say. Another difference is that in AlphaZero, they have a kind of perfect simulator. If you want to measure the boot time, well, you will have to repeat maybe the experiments. You will have to be careful about the hardware. You will have to be careful about many factors. So technically, it's kind of hard to engineer. So am I saying that taming the Linux kernel configuration space is harder than AlphaZero? Well, it's comparing something totally different, but it's just to put the problem in perspective and to show that it's about the number of configuration, but it's also about the cost of exploring the configuration space and to technically instrument the process. So our idea is that, okay, you cannot build this huge number of configurations, that's not possible. So one appealing approach is to use statistical learning because we believe it really fits to the problem. The idea is that you take only a sample of configuration that are used as examples, you train your algorithm, and then you hopefully it can predict to the whole configuration space. So if I take the example of whether a configuration build or fail, it can be framed as a classification problem. So you build some configuration, you observe whether it builds or not, so you attach a label to each configuration, build, failure, and then you can train a classifier that can predict out of options value, what will be the outcome. So you take it as example of your learning algorithm. If I take size, that's be the same story. You can have a corpus of configuration for which you have the measure of interest. Here's the size. You use this sample to train your algorithm, and then out of a new .config, maybe you can predict in an accurate way what will be the kernel size. Okay, so that's the general idea. That's the direction we have taken. So that's the big picture. We have TuxML, right? It's a variant of Tux that is capable of predicting the future, let's say, to exaggerate a bit. And it can be whether it builds or not. It can be the size. It can be the boot time, whatever. In this talk, I will mostly focus on build status and size. But the applicability seems quite general. But as a researcher, we were intrigued by this idea because, okay, many people did try this idea, right? Including on software system. They use a sampling, measuring, learning technique. But at the scale of Linux, we don't know. So as scientists, we are very interested to know whether it works or not. So in the rest of the talk, I will provide some answer, at least the results we have, and how we instrument the process, how we gather data. And I will show you two applications. One is build failure understanding and prevention. So it can help to identify which combination of options are responsible of a failure. And it can be used to prevent bugs at the continuous integration level. And another application is kernel size prediction. So given a configuration, are we able to predict its size without having to compile it? And then I will conclude with a discussion with you about some challenges, right? So we developed this TuxML tool 2 years ago. So it started slowly. And the basic setup is like that. So we randomly generate configuration. So we do that in the large, and we use a randconfig, which is a utility in the kernel source tree that is able to generate one configuration file that is consistent with the kconfig semantics and constraints. So it's a nice tool, and you can call it many times, and you can get many .config, right? And then we have a build process that is automated that compiles each .config and that observes something on the build process. So we observe, at the moment, two things, whether it builds or not. We collect many things like warning messages, failure messages, or everything is OK messages. And then we also collect some sizes. I will explain afterwards. OK, so that's the general process. And then the idea is that we have this huge table that we can use to train a classifier. And here we can use statistical machine learning. So we have a tool. It's open source. It's on GitHub. It's based on Docker and Python. So why Docker? It's because we would like to have a reproducible environment with all tools, packages needed, and to control in a fine-grained way the version. And also, we want to deploy the system on different machines because, you know, we won't compile with my machine so much kernel. So we have to be smart here. So you can use it and populate the database. So what we compute is at the end we have a huge database when we gather some information about compilation time, the configuration file, many errors, warnings, etc. The compiled kernel size and many compressed compiled kernel size. So we did that for two versions of Linux. So we are a bit outdated, I'm very sorry, because we start 2 years ago. And that's why we are targeting this version, 4.13.3. So it's not that we are obsessed by this version. It's just that it was a stable version, an interesting one at the time. And yeah, we have this huge data set of 95,000 configurations, so just for Linux 4.13. And we have distributed the computation on a grid computing that we have at INRIA, and we count that it's 15,000 hours of computation. So it's a lot of investment, I would say, even if I'm not paying anything. Okay, and we did that also for Linux 4.15. And for both, we restrict a bit the configuration space. We only target x86, and even further, we target x86 on 64 bits. It was our arbitrary decision, okay, just to focus on one architecture at a time. So the results I will present are only for 4.13. We have other results, but it's not yet published. Okay, so we have this result, and yeah, what we observe is that we have more than 3,000 configuration failure. It means that almost 6% of build lead to failures. So should we send 3,000 bug reports to the mailing list? No, we don't. We didn't. Because we look a bit at why there are so many failures. So the first observation, now it's kind of obvious, but is that in fact, when you have one configuration bug, it can lead to many configuration failures. So for instance, we observe a recurrent failure with a recurrent error message. It appears more than 300 times. But it is due to the same buggy combination of options, which is DRM, VBox video, and generic allocator. If you set some value to these specific options, so the wrong one, it leads immediately to this kind of failure. So actually, you can summarize a cluster of failures with one bug. That's the first good news for explaining and lowering the number. And actually, statistical learning can automatically identify which options are causing this failure. So we come to this conclusion, the DRM, VBox video, and generic allocator, through the use of statistical learning. So the principle is like that. You have a training set, build, fail, failure, build, failure, build, failure. And at the end of the day, you have a big matrix, right? With 95 rows, each is a configuration, and 12,000 options, because on x86, it's less, right? And yeah, maybe you can recognize a pattern here that leads to a failure. So it's related to what I said. It's related to DRM, VBox video, and generic allocator. So of course, as a human, you won't analyze this matrix. There are some tools for that. And this is where we apply statistical learning. And there are many algorithms out there, from basic linear regression to neural networks. And an happening one is classification tree, because it's a good trade-off between interpretability and accuracy. So by interpretability, I mean that you can extract out of the box some rules that state whether it leads to build or failure. And the classification tree, I'm sure you can quickly understand. If you activate generic allocator with DRM VBox video, yeah, it leads to an orange box, which is a failure. And just before, you observe that there are some other options. Three individual options. It means that by just activating this option, it leads to a failure. Okay, I will get back to this in a few minutes. Okay. Okay, so we use statistical learning, and we find interesting results. But one thing that came across, and that was not so obvious, is that some configuration bugs can actually mask some other configuration bugs. So I don't know if you're aware of that or if it's well known in the Linux community, but basically the bug with DRM box video and generic allocator was sometimes combined with another bug. And so what is the failure message? So I won't enter into the details, but basically, statistical learning is not enough. You have to combine also the error messages together. And then the idea is to predict not only whether it builds or fails, but the kind of failure it leads. And thanks to that, we can identify some masking bugs, I would say. But that's an important insight, because the trend is really apparent. There are some configurations with three bugs at the same time, and many with two bugs at the same time. It is an issue, right? So here is a list. And now I have a good news also for the Linux community, is that the number of failures is huge. It's because of us, TuxML. So three configuration bugs explain most of the failure, actually, and it was due to our infrastructure. So we can say we are a bit stupid and we are not enough knowledgeable about Linux, which may be true, but in fact, we look at the kconfig documentation about this option, and it has been then updated with new instructions. They recognize that basically it was not well explained how to use this option, because it requires basically specific tools. It was hard to anticipate everything right from the start. So at the end, there are only 16 bugs of Linux, which is kind of incredible. We made lots of computation, right? It's not much. So the main lessons learned, there are much more detail in the paper, is that first, don't trust your configuration build infrastructure. But I think it can be a kind of lesson to approaches like Zero Day or KernelCI. I don't know if you already have this kind of problem, in that you have some kind of false positive failure. It's due to the way you instrument the build process. In fact, it's happening a lot outside of Linux. The second lesson is, prevent as early as possible configuration bugs. It's kind of obvious, but here I have an additional argument, is that otherwise you won't see other bugs, because some bugs are hitting other. And with TuxML, we can have a kind of bug in understanding. We pinpoint what are the responsible options, and we can even prevent failures. So the idea is that when you run a build process, a continuous integration system, it may be smart to not build configuration for which you know it will anyway lead to failure. Otherwise, you are losing a lot of resources. This is what we did, actually. And so now we have a mechanism to anticipate this kind. And of course, some fixes can save the place, but it can be after 1 month, 2 months, or whatever. OK? So that's all for the first application. Now I have a second application. So it's a bit different in terms of motivation, but fundamentally, for us, it's almost the same. So there are lots of discussion about kernel size. So there are some pointers, including at Embedded Linux conference, right? There was a nice buff with Alexander Sack. A very nice talk of Michael Obnecker on bootlin on boot time reduction, and many tricks were somehow related to kernel size. And I don't know if I can claim that, but I have impression that nobody knows the precise effect of combination of option on size. So there are some documentation on kconfig, but it's only a few, and it's documentation, so it's not really actionable, I would say. There are some details in the paper. So our idea was, let's use a sampling, measuring, and learning approach. We try to train a predictor, a regressor here, that can predict a quantitative value, which is the size of the kernel. Okay? And the idea is that based on that, we can build tools that support smart configuration, I would say. So basically, you can activate, deactivate options, and without building it, without having the cost of building it, you can already know what will be the size. So we can envision some optimizer, like, yeah, give me the smallest kernel. Recommender, like, you should activate this option, deactivate this one, blah, 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 and get your objective. Or be the, I would say, smarter configurator that guides you throughout the configuration process. Another idea is to improve the documentation, to identify what are the influential options. So we launched the process. I have to be quick here. But so basically, we measure the size, and we measure many many things. So we measure the size of VM Linux, and the size also of the compressed size. And then we use statistical learning with some advanced mechanism. I will get back to it. We try on many algorithms, and as an outcome, we have some numbers about how accurate our model and what are the most influential options in terms of size. So about size, as I say, we compute many kinds of size, right? So VM Linux and compressed sizes. So briefly, I will comment on compressed size. So here, there is no learning. It's just raw results. So basically, you know, there are many compression options in the Linux kernel. So you have LZO, BASIP2, etc. And what we observe is that indeed XZ is the best in terms of compression rate. So it's kind of confirmation. There are some elements in the documents that's kind of funny to compare the numbers and the insights. So if you're interested by this aspect, I can share you the number. But yeah, it's just one result into the journey, right? And what we did is to predict the size of VM Linux and the size of compressed size. So here I will focus on VM Linux, the size of VM Linux. So the distribution is like that. So the tiniest kernel is the one of tinyconfig. So congratulations to the tinyconfig creator, because yeah, it's the right strategy. So tinyconfig, it's basically make no to all options and then setting 4 or 5 options. And yeah. At the maximum, yeah, it can be more than 1 gigabyte, which is kind of huge. So you activate everything, the debugging, etc., and you get that. So the question we ask to ourselves is, are we accurate? So are we able to predict the right numbers? So the table is a bit technical to understand, but On the left side, there are many kinds of algorithms for very, very basic ordinary least standard regression, which is very basic, two neural networks, which are kind of advanced. And some are more or less interpretable, right? So a neural network, it's hard to then extract what features matter, for instance. And we use a technique called feature selection, in which you don't use all options to predict the size, but only a subset. And feature selection can be automated. It was not human knowledge, or it was purely automated. And we have some good news. So the first one, I think, is the low prediction error. It's something like 7, which is okay, and it can be up to 5 at the end. And the other good news, I think the most important one, is that only a few features, a few options, have actually an influence on the size. Okay. And for compressed size, it's even easier to predict. So it's up to 3%. We have some similar table. So it means that we can have good prediction, and we can envision to have kind of smart configuration assistant. The other key result is that thanks to our prediction model, we can identify influential options. Okay, so we use some interpretable models, of course. And we have a list, right? An ordered list. So for VM Linux, the first one is debug info. Okay, good guess. The second one is yes. What yes means? It's the number of options that have the yes value in the config file. So it's a derived feature. Okay, we believed it was interesting to put in. And it's the second one. So it sounds obvious, right? It means that if you want to reduce your kernel size, remove options. Put no, 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 no. That's the most effective strategy, much more than tweaking others. And tinyconfig actually wins for that particular reason. And also tinyconfig also wins because it deactivates all influential options, and you can have a list, right? So we are working on it, but basically we have confront our result to the documentation. We have found options that are not documented at all and that have an impact on size. We have also found cases in which we miss some options, basically because we do not have in our data set the option activated, for instance. So it was not the fault of the learning, it was the fault of the exploration of the configuration space. So what we hope is that we can improve the documentation, and we are working with a bunch of people here. And if you're interested to help us to validate our results and basically to improve the knowledge about configuration options, you're really welcome. Okay, so to summarize, we use statistical learning to predict size, to prevent some bugs, to understand some bugs. So there are many interesting applications, and the results look promising. But still, we can discuss a lot of insight. So retrospectively, and despite our huge amount of computation, we found relatively few bugs on Linux. So there are three hypotheses. The first one is because of the Linux community. I think everyone here buys that. And yeah, that's incredible, the number of contributors there are for an open source product. So it can be one of the reason. And congrats to you. Congrats to all of us, right? But we can have also other hypotheses. Maybe it's due to the specific version of Linux we choose. Maybe it was too stable, I don't know. So we are replicating this experiment now. and maybe it is due to the way we sample. Because actually we are working with runconfig, but runconfig does not produce uniform random samples. Okay. And we know why, it's because it's a very difficult problem to produce uniform random samples out of constraints over Boolean variables. That's actually a huge research topic right now. but fair enough, runconfig has a big utility. And another hypothesis that maybe the testing effort has too much overfit on runconfig. So I think we need more innovation here. And we are working hard to explore differently the configuration space. Another challenge is that the cost. If we have to redo all our experiments at each commit, at each release, no way. Okay, so there are two ideas here. One is incremental build of configuration, because right now, at each time we build the configuration, we restart from scratch because of randomness, right? And to be sure that there is no interference and so on. But maybe we can be smart here and have a more incremental build. So that's an idea we are investigating. It can decrease the amount of time you need to get the status. Another idea is to transfer prediction model. So bugs do not transfer well because fixes are quick, right? But kernel size, we can hope it can transfer. I mean, we have some knowledge we reuse throughout our time, so hopefully we can transfer our prediction model from one version to another. There are some techniques here and can drastically reduce the cost. Another challenge is that, I'm really new to the community. I found the kernel CI initiative awesome. We really need to have an integrated initiative for collecting data. Our focus is mainly more in configuration in the large. And we believe also that learning technique can be used for kernel CI or zero day. So we're looking for data and for sharing our data and to use your data. So hopefully we can unify the force. And of course, there are other properties you want to predict, whether it boots, whether it's secure, so for whatever definition of secure you have. We have also interesting data set about warnings. There are many warnings that pops out. In fact, 90% of configuration are subject to warnings. So, and different warning messages. And what we believe is that it's not only about learning and that's it. It's really about communicating the results with the community. And also, we need the community to help the learning. For instance, you need some knowledge to apply smart sampling because you know that some options are interesting to look at. Or you need some, you have some knowledge about the important options and can validate somehow the prediction model. So basically, we need you. That's all. I'm running out of time, but we can have question maybe, right? I use all my time to present everything. I'm very sorry about that, but we can have questions. So thank you. That's it for this talk.